Over 60% of enterprise code commits now include AI-generated content. Yet that same code is 30% more prone to logical errors. This means that developers are leaning into what many call vibe coding, relying on AI intuition over structured design. The question isn't whether AI can write code, it's whether we can still trust it. My name is Paul Nashawaty. I'm the Practice Lead and Principal Analyst for Application Development. I'm joined by David from CodeRabbit. David, how you doing?
Good, good. Thanks. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks for being on. Super interesting comment, questions, you know, conversation we're going to have here. Why don't you introduce yourself and CodeRabbit to the audience?
Yeah, sure. So my name's David Loker. I'm Director of AI at CodeRabbit. That's where I lead development of agentic AI systems for code review and general developer workflows. I've been published at some very top conferences, NeurIPS, ICML, AAAI, and I've been building large-scale AI systems for about 20 years now.
Awesome. Well, it's great to have you on our podcast. The audience is very much interested in this topic, you know, when it comes to vibe coding and whether or not it's here to stay or if it's just kind of a fad or whatever. But we'll look into it, right? And we'll kind of expose some of the information that we're finding. In our research, we find that over 55% of enterprise code now includes AI-generated snippets. This is pushing developers into what the Cube is calling vibe coding and what we're looking at it from that perspective, but we're relying on an AI intuition over upfront design, right? And this is a little bit different. Like when you take tools like GitHub Copilot, it speeds commits to up to nearly half, but AI-generated code also sees higher bug rates is what we're seeing in our research. So in this episode, what we're really trying to understand and explore is how developer speed can balance between that trust and maintainability, but also whether AI is ready to really earn real commit rights. So David, when we jump into this, again, super important topic, right? When we jump into this, we see, I mentioned it, that our study suggests that over 55% of new code in the enterprise repositories are now including AI-generated snippets. What are your thoughts around how developers are balancing efficiency gains with tools like GitHub Copilot and the potential risk of introducing unseen errors or security gaps?
Yeah, so I think that's a really great point. Like there's a lot of productivity gains that can be had through AI-generated code. At the same time, having a quality assurance, you know, buffer between that code and production systems is still an ever-growing problem, and it's becoming more prevalent, as more AI-generated code is introduced into systems. That's where, you know, AI-generated code review comes in, and also because that burden is insurmountable at this point when it comes to humans doing the sole lift of the PR code review. And I think one of the reasons you're seeing, you know, so much of this AI-generated code going into systems is because these tools are actually quite valuable when it comes to speeding up productivity, right? And so people are getting value out of those tools. And so the question becomes, as people learn how to use them better, will they find that there are ways of getting code out of them that doesn't have as many of these flaws, and then using AI code review as a stopgap measure, and then the human review process on top of that?
I can appreciate that, David. I mean, I want, in our research, we see that organizations are really trying to release code faster, right? We saw 24% of respondents indicate that they want to release code on an hourly basis, yet only 8% are able to do so. So in your opinion here, or, you know, based on some of the your findings and such, do you find or do you think that we're coding faster or we're just getting better at writing flawed code more quickly?
Yeah, so I think right now we're still in this transition. We're trying to figure out how to use these systems in a way that doesn't end up polluting our system with unmaintainable code or codes that's riddled with bugs. And so we're still in that moment. And I think there's going to be some growing pains in there. Ultimately, the push towards using it is so strong at this point that I think we're going to see people figure out how to use them in an effective way. And so I don't think we're going to put the genie back in the bottle at this point. I think we're going to have to learn what to do and how we're supposed to get a code system from this prototyping stage of like, it has a ton of bugs, but I've got something to test, to how do I roll this out en masse to a large audience. And I think despite all these issues with the current systems, people are starting to figure out there are ways of integrating them into your workflow that are very effective. And if you do it in a systematic way, you can actually do so while mitigating some of these underlying issues. And again, the review process is going to become more and more of a bottleneck as we go forward.
I think that's fair. I mean, I also believe that the low code, no code, having the citizen developers doing the heavy lifting for like working with writing code for their own business purposes versus having the professional developers write code is going to need that quality check as well. We're seeing in our research that nearly 40% of developers describe the current workflow with AI as vibe coding. And this is relying on that institution of AI really feedback loops rather than structured architecture up front, right? So this is really what, when we look at those citizen developers, we look at the lines of business and they're trying to achieve a goal. They're basically building on the fly, right? They're not building a structured architecture and then like building to code. They're building it based on what they're seeing. So how do you see this shifting developers' mindsets? And is vibe coding really going to be the future of rapid prototyping? Or is it a warning sign for long-term maintainability, really?
Yeah, at this point, I'd be pretty concerned if people are just using that technique and then checking code directly into production. I think what this does do and what I am excited about when it comes to the idea of vibe coding is it opens up the space of development to people who don't know anything about coding, right? And so I could come in as someone who has an idea and I can vibe code something and get a prototype out. And maybe that I then have to hire maybe a real engineer who has a lot of experience to bring that to bear. But my ideas now, I can actually build them. And that's something that we didn't have before. And so we have to keep this balance in mind. Like there's more and more code being generated. And there's also more ideas coming to fruition. And I think that's a good thing. I think when it comes to using it right now and just vibe coding into the way you're talking about, like using the feedback loop, that is a very scary proposition for a lot of enterprises, right? And that's why they're still figuring out how they're going to measure that those systems and their usage and mitigate some of those potential issues.
All right, so let's pivot a little bit, right? We talk about vibe coding. I think we talked about that a lot there, and I think it makes a lot of sense. But we also see in this 2025 report that we found that 68% of developers trust AI-assisted code reviews more than they trust peer reviews, right? So now we're, and really, you know, we're relying on AI to do that, what a human was doing in the past. But this is really around catching syntax and logic issues, right? So that piece, it makes sense to me, because if you're walking through the process of the code, making sure things are working, all makes sense to me. But yet we also found that only 22% of respondents trust them for architectural design flaws. Now that's a big difference, right? When you're looking at it for like maintaining and checking your code, making it work, sure, you can use a tool for that. But when you're looking at the, you know, balancing the design against your architecture, I don't know if there's enough confidence there. So when we look at this, we're seeing AI fitting into the code review pipeline, should AI be a code reviewer, a validator, or eventually a lead reviewer in the whole process?
Yeah, that's a super interesting question. I think the reason why people trust them to that degree to do code reviews is because AI doesn't get tired. It pays attention to every single line. It can find these little tiny inconsistencies between comments and code and all these off by one errors and syntax issues, security issues, and so on. And so I think that's very important. The more code you produce, the more that's necessary. But when it comes to these architectural design issues, right? Some of those, there are multiple right answers. And sometimes the one you pick is based on things like business decisions, or it could be that right now I want something out quickly. I don't have time to architect this big, big thing. I want to build something much smaller. And so sometimes those decisions might be different than what the AI might consider. Will we get there? I think building these systems in and having us understand the business decisions and having the AI get that is still a little ways off, but I think we can get there. And eventually I do hope that we will have AI systems that are effectively a lead reviewer and just taking feedback and more like an iterative partner. Why would you, these are three options, which one would you like? And these are why I would think you would pick one versus the other, and more of an interactive flow.
Yeah, I agree with you. I right now, I believe that there's definitely a need for human in the loop, right? You need to make sure that we have that checks and balances in place. The more we feel confident around the tools doing the work, the AI doing the work, then we can start letting them be, you know, potentially at some point letting AI be the lead reviewer. But right at this point, I think human in the loop makes a lot of sense. But that's interesting, because when I think about the latest metrics from GitHub, it's showing AI code assistance reducing time to commit by up to 46%. That makes a lot of sense. But what we're seeing is post-development bug density in AI-generated code is 30% higher on the average. That is just saying, okay, well, you can commit the code quicker, right? Getting it into GitHub, but you're basically putting in bad code, right? So when we look at that, how does engineering teams really reconcile the trade-offs between speed and stability? And is the ROI really worth the rework that follows? And, you know, I would say that this is really a shift that we're seeing in the CI/CD pipeline, where historically, a couple of years ago even, I saw the business KPIs for DevOps being push the big green button, get the code out the door. Now it's making sure that you're putting quality code out the door. What are your thoughts around that?
Yeah, so I think this comes back to the idea of, should we be doing this, right? And at the end of the day, when you're pushing massively bug-dense code, I think the answer is you need to reevaluate how you're using the code generation tools, right? Maybe they're not supposed to be used in a way that people are using them in this. I'm just going to ask it to do something. I'm going to let it go off. I'm just going to let it run, right? I'm going to commit whatever code comes out of that. I find that when I engage with these systems, it's a very intellectual process that I'm constantly iterating with it and catching it and making sure it's doing things in a very specific way. And so that not only helps me understand the code that's being generated at a high and a low level, but also helps me prevent certain things from happening. And so this idea of the pure vibe coding market right now, as AI generated code stands right now, is still very flawed in the sense that you're going to get a lot of bugs getting into GitHub if you're going to commit that. You can use these systems in a very deeply intellectual way that's very exhausting, so to speak. By the end of the day, I feel exhausted having used it that way. But it also helps me produce more code than I would if I was doing it by myself. So there's this balance, I think. And I think we haven't established what that looks like for a lot of companies and a lot of people that are engaging with the process. And so we have to worry about it. Yes, it's a very real issue. And I think, again, this comes back to the code review is an extremely important part of this process.
No, it's an evolution, right, David? I mean, when we look at how things are changing and evolving, it's about using the right tools for the right job. You know, despite AI tools writing these millions of lines of code daily, 9 out of 10 engineering leaders basically are saying that human review is still mandatory as part of the production push. Again, human in the loop. But at this point, we're not ready to just like give AI the keys to the kingdom and say go. But, you know, as we talk through this and as we learn it, if we're looking into the future, Dan, we're looking at how, you know, at what point do you think AI will truly earn the commit rights? And at what point governance and confidence thresholds would really be needed to be put in place before that happens? What are your thoughts?
This is a really, you know, interesting question. And I can draw a parallel to sort of the idea of self-driving cars, right? At what point do we allow them to just take over and drive for us en masse, right? And I think it comes down to trust and confidence. And so until we see the amount of bugs and we have these studies done that the code being output by these systems is en masse higher quality, fewer bugs, more maintainable than humans are doing by themselves, that there's still going to be a lot of skepticism. And people have immense amount of wealth and time spent making their current products work well. And so the idea of just turning it over is probably not going to happen in the next couple of few years even, right? It's going to be a gradual process where startups are more willing to do it because they have less resources. And so the idea of using these tools is very appealing versus a big company that ultimately wants to protect their IP and make sure that their existing millions of customers are not seeing a ton of bugs. And so I think getting it to them is the idea of the self-driving car being sort of just widely available. And so we'll get there, but it's going to take trust building to get there.
I couldn't agree more. You know, David, there's a lot here to think about. The audience is probably, I'm trying to figure out, like, well, are we for it? Are we against it? I mean, from my perspective, I'm for innovation. I'm for future growth. Change is inevitable. It's going to happen. But what would you leave the audience with here? With it? There's a lot we talked about around AI and using it and, you know, what steps they should take in their maturity. What are your closing thoughts on what we could share with the audience?
I think my closing thoughts, when I think about AI generated code, I think about the developer productivity space that we're in right now. I'm very excited for, and I hope people get out there and they actually try these systems, right? And try to find a way to work with them that makes sense and still engaging from an intellectual perspective. Don't just drop all the knowledge that you can gain by studying up on architecture and on system design and how to build software, because this comes to bear in using these systems to build software really quickly and a really a higher level than just straight up vibe coding. And so I would be excited. I would tell them to go out, try these tools out, find a way to work with them that works well for you. And at the end of the day, don't drop the code review.
Great advice, David. I really appreciate it. I appreciate you joining me today on this podcast. It's really exciting to have you on. Important topic for sure. We definitely want to keep this conversation going. I want to thank you. I want to thank a big thanks to everyone who tuned in. We really appreciate you being part of the AppDevAngle community. But for now, that wraps up this episode. And we'll be back next Wednesday with another conversation diving into the tools, trends, and talent shaping the future of application development. Whether you're deploying at the edge, building an AI, or modernizing your cloud stack, we've got you covered. Be sure to follow us on social if you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect. Until next time, stay curious and stay building.